buyers flip contracts. Buyers will go to a condominium project in a trailer somewhere and sign up one of these pre-construction prices and agree to buy a condo unit for $200,000. And it takes 3 years for the developer to build a condo. And 3 years later, that unit's worth $400,000. Mr. Buyer, who signed the contract here, he never really had the $200,000 anyway. But he was hoping that he'd be able to assign the contract to somebody else. So what he does is he assigns the contract to this, it's now worth $400,000. He assigns the contract to a buyer who pays him $150,000. And then at the closing, the seller conveys it to this guy for $200,000. So he pays $200,000 to the seller, and he's paid $150,000. This guy actually gets the apartment for $350,000. He's got a bargain. This guy, who's done nothing, has made $150,000. Does that make sense? The point is, you can assign a contract for money. It's not just like I'm moving to San Diego, I've lost my job, I'm really screwed here. Can I just recover my money? Sometimes you can make a lot of money. This is called assigning a contract, which a lot of people call flipping a contract. As you can imagine, the developer and the contract says, no, 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 you can't do that. What the developer would rather do is sign a new contract with this guy at $400,000. Have you go away. So he says, you want to cancel your contract? Fine, cancel your contract. But don't go assigning it to somebody and making $150,000. It really ought to be not. Or $200,000, or whatever the difference is. The point is, developers prohibit assignment for all kinds of reasons, including people flipping the contract and making money on their piece of property, but also because you've agreed you want to deal with buyer. He's a good guy, he has a good reputation, I think he can do it, I think he has $1 million. You don't know whether this guy has any money or not. B picked this guy out. Now all of a sudden, I'm stuck in a deal with W. Who the hell he is? He may be Trump, he may be rude, he may not really have the money. I have no idea who I'm dealing with here. Well, I knew who I was dealing with here. This was the guy I wanted to deal with. You go pick somebody else, and all of a sudden, this guy has changed your deal, and now you've got a contract with this guy you never agreed to. So, of course, the seller's going to put a provision in the contract that says, no assignments without my consent. Just like he puts in a lease, no assignments or no subleases without my consent. We just don't have sub-assignments here.
You could.
This guy can sell with this guy. This guy can sell with this guy. Maybe by the time we get to closing, this guy can come close. The point is, without a prohibition, a contract is assignable either way. If the seller sells the land, he's going to assign the contract, which is assigning the rights to get the $1 million. Or if the buyer assigns a contract, he's assigning the rights to buy the property for $1 million. That's an assignment of a contract, just like we have assignment of leases. We're going to talk about now breach of contract. Breach of a contract is when somebody doesn't do what they said they were going to do. Breach is default. In the context of a lease, we talked about default. In the context of a sales contract, we say that a party has breached the contract and perhaps is in default. The reason I want to talk about it is I want to talk about two or three concepts and the three important remedies, and then we'll look at these when we get into a sales contract. A breach of a contract is either party not doing what it agreed to do. The text calls it an unexcused failure to perform. They're not excused very often. You didn't do what you said you did. The text talks about an anticipatory breach of contract. We're not going to get into that. All that means is an early breach, rather than, in other words, under our 30-day thing, rather than waiting 30 days to see if the guy breached. If at 15 days he said, I'm not closing, well, that's an early breach. That's not anticipatory breach. That's not a big deal. The text also talks about substantial performance, and it goes off into the concept of, did you pretty well perform, but not 100% perform, That's not worth getting into either. In our context, either closed or you didn't close. You either paid your million or you didn't. It doesn't mean, oh, okay, I showed up at the closing, won $900,000, that's pretty good. No. We're not gonna talk about substantial performance. But what we are gonna talk about is the remedies for breach of contract. And the first remedy when a party has breached is my favorite, and I think is the most important, and I want you to learn, is the most powerful remedy to make a party, to penalize a party for his failure to perform. And it is called specific performance. And it is exactly what it sounds like. Your Honor, make him do what he said he'd do. Specifically enforce the contract. The party who alleges the other party has defaulted goes into court and says, Your Honor, make him do what he said he'd do. Simply, here, if we get to 30 days and the seller says, I've just decided not to sell to you anymore. I think it's worth $1.2 million now. I'm not selling to you for $1 million. The buyer goes into court and sues the seller and says, Your Honor, make him sell it to me for $1 million. That's specific performance. Make him do what he said he'd do in the contract. And the opposite can happen, although practically it usually doesn't. We waited 30 days, and the buyer didn't show up with his $1 million. The seller can go into court. Your Honor, make him give me the $1 million. I was there with the deed. I was ready to sell. I did everything I was supposed to do. He didn't show up with his $1 million. Your Honor, make him give me the $1 million. I think this is by far the most powerful remedy under any contract situation. And frankly, to me, it is the most fundamental fairness. It is the most correct thing to do. We signed a contract. This is what we agreed to do. Your Honor, he didn't do it. Make him do it. That's called specific performance. That's a very powerful remedy in a real estate contract situation. Make that seller give me that property for $1 million that he's now decided not to do. Could very well be that all of a sudden during those 30 days, Walmart bought the property next door and they would like to have your property as a parking lot and they've offered you $2 million for it. And you really regret signing that contract for $1 million. That's tough. Buyer can make you do it. That's specific performance. Okay. There are two more things that a court can do. The parties can go into court and say, Your Honor, I'd like you to rescind the contract. We talked about this a little bit in the lease situation. Rather than saying, Your Honor, make him sell it to me for $1 million. Rescission means cancel the agreement. The buyer goes in, and if the seller is not closing, has refused to close, and the buyer says, you know, rather than making him sell it to me for $1 million, I'd just like to have my deposit back. Your Honor, rescind the contract means let's put us both back in the situation we were before we ever entered into this contract. What that means is there's no longer an agreement to pay money. There's no longer an agreement to convey. And if the buyer had paid a deposit, like in this case, he often might have had a $50,000 deposit up, the court would say, give it back. That's rescission. Rescission is not enforce the contract to make him do it. Rescission is cancel the contract, put us both back where we were before we ever entered into this deal. Okay, and the last one is damages. And we're going to talk about damages in a lot of different contexts in following chapters when we get into all the types of things that can happen and what damages are. The damages are simply, what money did you lose? If the seller refuses to convey and his property is now really worth $2 million and the seller won't convey, you can go into, if you can prove that property is worth $2 million, Tom, the buyer can come in and say, never mind, I don't want to buy it for $1 million anymore. Your Honor, I just want you to give me that $1 million profit that I would have made if you had sold it to me. Those are my damages. I lost $1 million. And conversely, if buyer agreed to pay $1 million and something went terribly wrong, like chlorine was found in the ground nearby, and it was a problem, and now this property is only worth $700,000, seller could sue the buyer and say, you know what? If you had closed, I'd have gotten $1 million. It's not only worth $700,000. I want $300,000 from you for my damages, because I would have made $300,000 benefit in that deal that you agreed to pay me $1 million. It can go either way. The point is, damages, you've heard about damages all your life. Damages in a personal injury situation, damages in our kid going off the diving board, his damages are $11 million. Damages are how much are you hurt by the fact that the other party did not comply with what the contract said he would do, what he said he would do in the contract. Now, there's one more concept I want us to understand, and then we are done with this chapter, because I'm going to tell you the rest of it, we're not going to dwell on it. There is a concept called liquidated damages. It's a sub-concept of damages. In other words, there are three remedies: specific performance, rescission, and sue for damages. And understand, under our sue for damages here, sometimes if a seller refuses to close, the buyer has more damages than just the buyer of the property. He's paid a surveyor, he may have paid an architect for plans, he may have paid a lawyer attorney's fees, he may have all kinds of costs. He may have spent a year trying to get this property rezoned and spent a bundle, and then the seller refuses to sell. In other words, it's not just a difference in value, it can be what we call out-of-pocket damages. What do I spend?
Money.
What are the damages? Now, we want to talk about liquidated damages for 2 seconds, and then we're going to quit. Liquidated damages are where the parties agree in a sales contract in advance, saying, if there is a default, we agree right now, this is what the amount of damages are going to be. It's an agreement today that says, if there is a default in the future, rather than coming into court with appraisers and experts and all this stuff, we agree right now the damage is going to be a certain amount, and that's liquidated damages. And let me tell you where that comes up in 9 out of 10 of your deals. Or no, 99 out of 100 of your real estate deals. In this deal, for $1 million, and the buyer put up a $50,000 deposit in escrow, the parties agree in advance that the liquidated damage amount, if the buyer refuses to close, is that he loses his deposit. The parties have agreed, let's don't go into any of this junk about it's worth $700 now, or it's worth $2 million now. Let's don't get into any of that crap. If the buyer refuses to close, we agree the damages, we agree now in advance, the damages will be $50,000. And in a real estate sales contract, that damages amount is the amount of this deposit, because the contracts say so. They say if the buyer fails to close, he forfeits his deposit. The deposit goes to the seller, and both parties agree right now up front when we sign the contract that that's the liquidated damage. That's what the damages will be when we agree in advance in the event the buyer doesn't close. A predetermined, pre-agreed to amount of damages is liquidated damages, and that's what it is. Now, there are a bunch of concepts following this in your textbook. Ignore them all. The text talks about you can foreclose a contract. We don't do that anymore. We don't have foreclosures of contracts. And then the text talks about discharge, novation, and accord, and satisfaction. Contract lawyers fight over this crud all day long. And you don't need to. And that is the end of chapter ten, and that is our discussion of general contract law. Does anyone have any questions? Okay, then we're gonna have your midterm exam in 5 minutes.
Yay.
If y'all will be putting stuff away, like your computer desk completely, no cell phones, no books, no notes, no tablets, no nothing. I'd like you to have a pen or a pencil. And I got paper for you. And we'll do the midterm at 4:00.
My brain is so fried already. I can't think.
I don't have that mechanical pencil. I have a shitty pencil. Mechanical?
Erase in case.
Let me tell you basically what's going on. You're going to answer 10 questions. I've given you 11 questions. Pick your best 10. Cross out one. Often hear moaning and groaning, oh my God, I can't decide what to do. Anybody who doesn't understand that that's a blessing, that your one bad question you get to delete, raise your hand.
There's a name on this one. Evan?
Give me that back if you want. I'm sorry, that one's supposed to be in the stack. Yeah, gentlemen, already taken with that. Does everybody have one?
No.
That's the last one. Okay, cool. All right. Obviously, print your name at the top. Sign your name at the bottom, which is an honor pledge. Fill in your answers. Answer 10 questions, not 11. Cross out one of them. Put a big X through the one you're not going to answer. If you answer all 11 questions, I'll pick which one to leave, and it'll be your best. So follow the instructions, please. Write your answers in the space provided if you can, best you can. If you got to go over a word or two or something, you'll find a spot for it. But the idea is to try to keep your answer pretty short. You have 1 hour to do the test. We'll conclude at 5:02. I predict most of you will finish in a half hour, some 45 minutes. One or two will take the whole hour, and if it were 3 hours, they would take the 3 hours. So the point is, it's not an hour test, but you've got an hour to do it. Good luck.